Well, the war of words over the nation's borders erupted yesterday. Three premiers offering three very different outlooks on the country's path out of the pandemic. Treasurer Josh Frydenberg joins me now from Canberra. Nice to see you this morning, Treasurer.
Nice to see you, Ali.
So Queensland Premier said yesterday she's not keen on opening until kids are vaccinated. We know that nowhere in the world is giving the jab to under 12s yet. That pretty much stuffs up your plans, doesn't it?
Well, that position is not consistent with the medical advice that we have. That is, that Australia should stick to the plan and open up at 70 to 80% vaccination rates. We do know that kids can get COVID, but we also know from the medical experts that the virus is much less severe, the illnesses are much less severe in kids, and that the vaccine has been approved for those who are 12 to 15, as well as, of course, the 16-plus population.
So and what
therefore,
did you make
we're
of
rolling
her comments,
out the vaccine
then?
To those people. Well, I thought it was another delay of what is inevitable, namely that Queensland and Western Australia should join with the rest of the country and open up in accordance with the plan. My message to the premiers and the chief ministers is very clear. Do not delay the inevitable. You have to learn to live with COVID. COVID may come to your state within a week. It might be a month. It might be a little bit after that. But the reality is we can't eliminate the virus. And there's only one pathway out, Ali, and that's to get people vaccinated. And it's so pleasing to see the vaccination rates in New South Wales and Victoria on the rise. And we want to see Queensland and Western Australia catch up with them because it's a national target and it's one that that will give people hope. And yesterday we saw 80 of Australia's largest companies go very public in calling on the premiers, the chief ministers and the federal government to stay the course, to give people hope and to stick to the plan.
I mean, we saw a very different message from the New South Wales Premier yesterday. She's waiting for no one. The issue is you could be a world-class negotiator and there is no way you're getting all of the premiers on the same page.
Well, at the end of the day, they've got to serve their communities and their community is going to be best served by sticking to the plan. It was prepared by the world-leading Doherty Institute. And I put to you, if it's not 70 to 80% when their state's open, then what is that vaccination rate? Mm. When do they believe that those tourism businesses in Queensland can once again have their customers come from interstate? When can Western Australian construction industry and mining players be able to get the skilled labour force that they need to continue to create jobs? That's what we need to focus on, strengthening the economy, but also giving families hope. You know, one of the great consequences and costs of this pandemic and the lockdowns has been the mental health issues. And I was so moved by that story on your program the other morning, Daisy's story, which just told of the impact on our young kids that the lockdowns are having. And the only way we can avoid that is to open up in accordance with the plan.
Are you going to cut off support once you reach 80% vaccination rates?
Ali, I've made it very clear the states and the territory should have no expectation that that level of economic support that we're providing today will continue once we reach those 70 to 80% targets. The Doherty Institute modelling says that stringent lockdowns become unlikely at that rate. There may be some transitions where you need to keep some health restrictions in place as you gradually open up. But the idea that we will be providing income and business support on the scale we are right now is wrong. We just can't afford to do it indefinitely.
All right, so Harvey Norman, which, as you know, made a huge profit last year, is repaying the $6 million it received in JobKeeper. I mean, that's nice, isn't it?
It's very welcome. And in March of this year, I was doing a radio interview and they asked me about Harvey Norman. I said, I would welcome them paying back. I would welcome any company that's in a position to pay back JobKeeper to do so.
Why don't you force them all to pay it back?
And yourself. Because when we put in place the program, the country was staring into an economic abyss. And we knew that if we didn't put in place a program like JobKeeper, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of Australians, would lose their jobs. And JobKeeper worked. It was described by the Governor of the Reserve Bank as a remarkable program. It avoided
Treasurer, I get all of that with all great respect.
The scarring in the labour market.
JobKeeper was amazing and it did its job. And people who asked for the money at the time didn't know whether or not or how their business was going to play out during that lockdown. But shouldn't everyone who made a profit and paid their bonuses to executives do the same thing as Harvey Norman and pay that money back?
I would welcome companies that are in a position to pay it back. But if you're putting to me that we should go and change the law retrospectively on people that applied and received that support in the middle of an economic crisis, I'd say no to that. Now, if the Labor Party are proposing to actually go back and get the money from small businesses from around the country who received JobKeeper, then we'll oppose that. Because the Labor Party are now coming after small business. 98% of the recipients of JobKeeper were small business. You go and talk to any small business that received JobKeeper and they will tell you it was a lifeline. Do you remember the images, Ali, last year of tens of thousands of our fellow Australians lining up outside Centrelink? Programs like yours were talking about it being like the Great Depression, reminiscent of the Great Depression. JobKeeper came in, it suddenly stopped that fall in business and consumer confidence, and it gave people hope, and it gave people and businesses certainty that they could plan for the future. Without it, we would have lost more than 700,000 jobs. Our unemployment rate could have reached 15%. It's now at a 12-year low. JobKeeper not only stemmed the tide of those job losses, but it has actually supported the recovery. That's critical to understand.
Treasurer, don't disagree with you there. I just think when it's taxpayers' money and we hear that people rorted the system, it just doesn't sit comfortably with people. But we appreciate your time this morning, as always. Have a good day.